Good evening and welcome to Calvary Christian Fellowship's Wednesday night Bible study on Revelation. We're so glad that you're joining us tonight. My name is Andrew Paino, and thank you again for viewing. Did want to let you know that these Wednesday night Bible studies will be able to be found on our Facebook page, and we also have a lot more of them on our YouTube page as well. So if you want to get caught up or rewatch some of our past studies, feel free to do so. They'll air live every Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. And you can find these videos on our social media pages just by liking us on Facebook, following us on Instagram and Twitter, and subscribing to our YouTube page. All of these can be found by searching for @CCFFortWayne on our social media pages. And we want to encourage you to share this video on your Facebook pages if possible, just to let others know what we're being a part of tonight. And we do also want to say thank you to all of you for your tithes and your offerings of support during this season. That allows us to continue to be able to do our ministry along with your prayers of support. And if you're being blessed by Calvary Christian Fellowship and want to make a donation, or if you consider us your church and you want to mail in your tithes and offerings, you may do so by mailing them to Calvary Christian Fellowship, P.O. Box 25544, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46825. I do also want to share with you that we do believe in prayer. And if you have any prayer requests or praise reports, something good the Lord's done in your life, we have the contact information on the screen, and we hope that you'll reach out to us using these various methods. We do pray over the needs that come into us, and we also rejoice in the good things that our great God is doing in our midst. As well as if you'd like to get a prayer shawl that we anoint over and pray, you may reach out to us with that information, and we'll be sure to send one out to you. And in addition, we have our 2020 Vision Notebooks. And those are $100, and they contain commentaries and outlines on the different books of the Bible, as well as the Apostles' Creed and other great resources for you throughout this year and in the years ahead. And if you'd like one, again, that cost is $100 with the proceeds going to our missions efforts. And finally, we want to invite you to come and be with us in person to worship and praise our great God. We meet every Sunday at 233 West Main Street, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46802, on Sundays at 10 a.m. And this is the community center located in the heart of downtown Fort Wayne. If you're looking for a landmark nearby, it's by Cindy's Diner. And again, that takes place this and every Sunday at 10 a.m. So we hope that we'll be able to see you in person. And again, thank you for your support and hope that you'll be ministered to now by one of these mini concerts by our missionary, Nancy Honeytree. God bless you.
Homemade bread, smell the fresh baked bread, coming from the heavenly baker. Homemade bread, it's the daily bread, baked by the miracle maker. The bread of life is baked on high and sent to you fresh every day. Wholesome and true and good for you. And you love it because it's homemade. Ooh, homemade bread. Now won't you come in and sit down. Come on now, let us wash the dust off your feet. We'll give you homemade bread. And any time you come to our house, there's always something good to eat. So come and feast on the Word of God while the table is laid. Hearty appetites will be satisfied, and you love it because it's homemade. Men cannot live on bread alone, but God by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. From the mouth of the Lord. So come and feast on the word of God while the table is laid. Hearty appetites will be satisfied, and you love it because it's homemade. Oh, you love it because it's homemade. Homemade bread.
I want to jump in, but I don't want to interrupt your concert that we're enjoying with you.
Praise the Lord.
You know, that's one of our promises in the book of Revelation. That the Lord said to the church at Pergamum, that we've been looking at in times past, the churches, that if they were to be overcomers, if they would become overcomers, that one of the promises was that he would give them hidden manna of the Word of God. And J.R. worked at, your husband, worked at Aunt Millie's bakery.
You know, one of the Psalms say, bread which strengthens the heart of man. And you know, he had heart problems, but he was able to work at Aunt Millie's for 8 years.
Wow.
And I believe that as the as he was getting that job, the Lord gave me that psalm, the bread which strengthens the heart of man. And I held on to that, that God was going to give him, you know, health and strength to work and to thrive and to do his ministry. And he really did. It was wonderful. But I just love all the metaphors in that song about how the Word of God is bread to us, and it's so nourishing. It just lifts us up, and your teaching does that for people. You know, I'm really honored to be a part of your teaching getting out to people, because the Word of God is, you know, if we were doing all of this, just doing this without the Word, it wouldn't mean anything. But it's the Word of God that's alive and active and that nourishes people. And
well, thank you for that. But Honey Tree, every song I've ever heard you do, well, maybe not Hummer Bummer, but you've got...
I beg your pardon.
Can I just share this about manna before you continue on in your concert?
Sure.
Because, you know, that hidden manna that the Lord promises to the church, the Word of God that you just sang to us about, it's found two places with the children of Israel, the church in the wilderness. It's found in two different locations. And it's sort of a challenge to us with your song, because you remember they were complaining that they missed the onions and the garlics and the leeks that they were having back in Egypt.
Right.
They had to really be hungry. And they must not have had great breath in Egypt. That's why they had to get out of there, maybe. I don't know. But when they were traveling and complaining, the Lord then gave them manna that he provided every morning. And they had enough for each day. Jesus in his prayer said, give us this day our daily bread. And the first account of it is found in Exodus chapter 16. And it says in this first account that the house of Israel named it manna. Those of us who have had women that are doing their first cooking, we've had manna. You know what manna means, right?
I think so.
What is it? I'll be in trouble later for that. But it says in Exodus 16:31, the house of Israel named it manna, and it was like coriander seed, white, and its taste like wafers with honey.
Wow.
And you know, talking about J.R. working at Aunt Millie's and the physical challenges he had, how God sustained him.
Yes.
That had to take a lot of discipline, because that's right across the street from where our church meets.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if Ben will jump in on this or not, but when we would walk out and that smell.
I love that whole, that fresh baked, the yeast, you know, the rising bread smell.
Oh.
It was wonderful.
It's wonderful.
And, you know, he knew a guy that was, whose job was to experiment and find new breads. And so he would bring home loaves of bread for us to try.
Mercy.
Yeah, it was really good.
Well, they were, you know, isn't that exciting? It was like honey. And like coriander, it was white. But, you know, a lot of people, that's just like the word of God in our life. We begin to take it for granted.
Mm.
And we don't keep it fresh in our life. And well, I would love for you to sing that song at our church sometime. I've never heard that one either, Honey Tree. But in Numbers chapter 11, listen to what it says when they had the manna. It says, now the manna, this is sometime later, was like coriander seed, and its appearance was like bdellium. It had lost being white. It was now an off gray.
Mm.
And it says that now they would have to grind it, and they would have to beat it, and they would boil it in the pot. You know, a lot of people, that's what the Word of God has become to them. Just, you know, it's laborious.
Mm.
And they're not getting the excitement and the thrill out of it. And instead of it tasting like honey, it said, and its taste was as the taste of cakes that were baked with oil. It was now bland to them. So thank you for a song that lets us know the Word of God. The Lord wants to give us hidden manna to keep it fresh.
Yes.
You know, they had enough to gather for a day. And on the day before the Sabbath of their rest, they gathered enough to carry over to not have to work.
Mm-hmm.
But if they kept it any other time, it would have worms in it.
Yeah.
And I couldn't help when you were singing that to go, that's the promise to the church. Overcoming people, the Word of God is more exciting to us today than even when we first heard it.
Amen.
And we're seeing fresh things that are there.
I know, always. It's endless. Well, let's sing another one that we know so well. Sing together. I see the Lord high and lifted up, seated on the throne of my life. I see the Lord high and lifted up, seated on the throne of my life. And he is holy. He is holy. He is holy. Seated on the throne of my life. I see you, Lord, high and lifted up, seated on the throne of my life. I see you, Lord, high and lifted up, seated on the throne of my life. You are holy. You are holy. You are holy. Seated on the throne of my life. And you are holy. You are holy.
look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. You are my story. Are my song, sweetly I'll praise You all the day long, forever and ever. Your praises I will proclaim until I behold You in glory. Oh, praise Your name. Yes, You are my story. Are my song, sweetly I'll praise You all the day long, forever and ever. Your praises I will proclaim until I behold You in glory. Oh, praise Your name. Isn't He wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's Word. Isn't Jesus our Lord wonderful? Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God is He. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. Wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God is He. He's saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. Yes, He's wonderful, wonderful, Jesus is to me. My Counselor, Prince of Peace, and Mighty God is He. Saving me, keeping me from all sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. I get so thrilled. with Jesus every moment of the day. I get so thrilled,
I get so thrilled
with Jesus. He's the truth, the life, the way. I get so thrilled with Jesus. He satisfies my soul. I get so thrilled with Jesus, for he has made me whole. I get so thrilled with Jesus every moment of the day. I get so thrilled with Jesus. He's the truth, the life, the way. I get so thrilled with Jesus. He satisfies my soul. I get so thrilled with Jesus, for he has made me whole. Well, Honey Tree, you bring that out in me.
I do it on purpose.
But tonight we need to get into the manna.
Amen.
The fresh bread, I hope it's going to be that.
Baked on high and sent to you fresh every day.
That's really a request. That's a great song.
Oh, thank you.
I love it. Like I'm all the rest.
I'm glad you like that one. And, I thought you would.
I really do. I like it a lot. Especially since we're right across the street, like I said, from Aunt Millie's. Mm-hmm. That just ought to be our theme song.
Right.
A lot of words, though. Well, speaking of words, we're going to look in Revelation chapter 4. Okay. We're zipping right through Revelation. And we're not going to do any reviewing.
Okay, good.
Okay. We're going to pick right up where we left off. And that is, now we're in part 2 of what John was given of the revelation. And that is now the things that are going to take place after the church is raptured and taken up to the throne of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That's what's next on the agenda. And that can happen anytime. We don't have to wait for anything to take place. That could happen while we're right here having Bible study tonight. That would be wonderful.
Yes.
The only reasons that I would want it to be delayed is I still have people that I love and care about that I'm not sure if the Lord were to come, they'd be ready. They will probably have an opportunity during the tribulation period to get saved, but the church will no longer be here.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we took a look that to the church, Jesus said, he that has ears to hear, talking to the church, listen to what the Spirit is saying. And we looked over how later in the tribulation period, it does say he who has ears to hear, but it doesn't add the Spirit speaking, because the instrument whereby the Spirit is speaking today is through the church.
Yes.
And there'll still be, the Holy Spirit will be reaching out to people during that tribulation period that we're going to be looking at in just a few days, the horrible things that are going to happen. I know that we were talking before the videoing tonight about how there just seems to be so many people fearful.
Yes.
Apprehensive.
Mm-hmm.
Concerned. And you shared with us how you were just even at a party and people wanted to have you minister song to them.
Yes. In a way, it's a good thing if we can be sensitive. We never know. It could be anyone that we meet on the street or in a store or that needs prayer. And we need to keep our eyes open and be ready to minister to people, because people are feeling very, very stressed.
And that's a reason for us to remain, to be here as the church.
Mm-hmm.
Like we like to say at Calvary Christian Fellowship, we try never to have church.
Mm-hmm.
We want to be the church.
Yeah.
And people can be that wherever they are.
Yes.
And in saying that, maybe the only other reason is to what we're going to look at tonight, And that's to have just a little longer to be able to say, Lord, I'd like to be able to earn just one more of these crowns that we're going to be looking at tonight. And if Ben would put it up for us, in Revelation chapter 4, well, actually, Ben, I'm going to go back to chapter 3 first, just for a moment, that lets us see a foreshadowing, and we're going to come back to this in just a moment. But there we see that one of the promises to the church, Revelation 3, verse 11, the Lord made a promise to the church at Philadelphia, that church of brotherly love, that they were, if they became faithful, they were going to get crowns. And the Lord gave them a warning about the crown. And he said, I'm coming quickly, and hold fast what you have so that no one will take your crown. You know, people can rob your joy. Mm-hmm. Circumstances can rob your peace. And a lot of things can come. Because Jesus said about Satan, he comes to rob and to kill, mm-hmm. and to destroy. He wants to take away. He'll never add anything to your life.
Yeah.
He only takes away. And he wants to take those crowns away, because now, Ben, if you'll go with me over to Revelation 4 in verses 10 and 11, both the verses, it says now that the 24 elders will fall down. Now, who are these 24 elders that are in heaven? Well, that's another name for the church, okay? The church is made up of Jew and Gentile. Mm-hmm. We're one in Christ. There's no more right. male and female. There's no more servant and free. There's no longer any of that in Christ. But particularly, no longer Jew and Gentile. We're reconciled together in Christ. Now, Israel had 12 tribes. Mm-hmm. And Jesus had 12 apostles, mm-hmm. okay? And we know that when Judas vacated his office, that the apostle Paul was the one that filled that in. Now, they cast lots to try to get somebody, but we never heard of the one that won the lots. He just kind of faded off in oblivion. That was man's doing, uh-huh. but God's doing was Paul to be that apostle.
Right.
So 12 and 12, that's a picture, the 24 elders okay. of the church around the throne of God. And it says that we're going to fall down before Jesus, who's sitting on the throne, and we're going to worship him who lives forever and ever.
Hallelujah.
That's why we challenge the people, Honey Tree, we better get used to mm-hmm. what we're doing here. And if people are uncomfortable or looking at their watches or bored, they're going to really have a hard time in heaven, because that's the atmosphere of heaven.
Yeah.
I love listening to praise and worship mm-hmm. during the day. And I was listening again to another one of Benny Hinn's worship.
They're wonderful.
On the YouTube. And I thought, Benny really needed to get a hold of I See the Lord, High and Lifted Up.
Oh, wouldn't he have done a nice job on I See the Lord?
Oh, Mike, can you imagine that filling the great arenas where those crusades mm-hmm. were held? That's a... To me, Honey Tree, that is one of the classics.
Thank you.
I really believe that of our worship and praise. But they're just singing the same one up there. Now, you put three holies in your uh-huh. song. That's all they're doing up there. Holy, mm-hmm. holy, holy. And they've been doing it for eternity.
Yeah.
And they're going to keep doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. That's going to be a thrill. And then it says, and these 24 elders will cast their crowns before the throne. Now, I've asked Ben to be using the New American Standard. I don't know if you, on verse 11, if you can switch over or not. But Honey Tree, do you remember this chorus that's right out of there that we can get practicing while we're down here? Thou art worthy. Mm. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory. Glory and honor, glory and honor and power.
Okay, that was in E flat. So could we put it here instead?
You can put it wherever you want, because I think it was going to hurt me in just a minute. Yeah.
Okay, well, let's start here then. No, that's good.
Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, glory and honor, glory and honor and power. For thou hast created, hast all things created. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are created. For thou art worthy, O Lord. That's what we get to sing up there when Amen. We cast our crowns before the Lord. Well, let's take a look at what the crowns are, because the scripture tells us very distinctly there are five of them. Five is the number of grace mm-hmm. in scripture. David picked up five stones that were smooth to be able to use, and we all love to tell it, one for Goliath, mm-hmm. and he had four for the brothers in case they showed up.
Yeah.
Okay, and he did that by God's grace, because mm-hmm. a little sling and a shepherd boy wasn't going to do much, but God's grace is the power of God
yes.
working in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
So we have five crowns, and the first is right there in Revelation. Revelation chapter 2 and verse 10. Remember we looked at the church at Sardis that was the church that was going to go through persecution?
Mm-hmm.
And we know that it says all who desire, Paul wrote to Timothy and said, all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer persecution.
Yes.
And, you know, we tend to think, well, the persecution is going to come. Well, tell that around the world mm-hmm. in a lot of other countries where you have gone
yes.
and have visited. I think of those ladies that came from Iran and at Easter time, how you were able to be a part of a service that went into Afghanistan, wasn't it?
No, that was Pakistan.
Pakistan, I'm sorry.
Easter time. But yeah, both of those countries have lived with persecution, and it makes a difference, I think, in their Christian life where they've come to a decision. I mean, they don't live in fear all day long or anything, but they do have to come to the decision that it's important. It's important enough to be a Christian that if I have to lay down my life to be a Christian, I've already decided to do that.
Well, there's a special crown that is called in Revelation 2:10. And Jesus said to that church that the devil's about to cast some of you into prison so that you will be, and there's the key word, you'll be tested
mm-hmm.
and you will have tribulation for 10 days, but be faithful unto death. And I'll give you, here's the first, there's the crown of life. And that crown of life comes when we face trials
mm-hmm.
in our life. You know, the enemy, if he can't rob and kill and destroy, he'll try to deceive us and delude us
mm-hmm.
and distract us. And he's taken people that face trials physically, and he's brought, look at the opiate epidemic that's mm-hmm. in our nation too. We don't talk much about that with the coronavirus mm-hmm. that's gone on, but that's been a major epidemic that's taken multiple lives. My first major addiction was when I got introduced to morphine.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not saying I didn't have other struggles with alcohol and some things in mm-hmm. my life, but boy, when I got introduced to morphine in the hospital, and I'll never forget Dr. Cashman coming in, because back then, that was 35 years ago,
mm-hmm.
they didn't have where you can hit a little button and it regulates
uh-huh.
what you're allowed to have. And because of every rib was broken and my lung was punctured and my back was broken, I was allowed to get morphine upon request. And boy, that was wonderful. I remember Dr. Cashman coming in and closing the door with tears in his eyes. Mm-hmm. And he said, "We've got a problem. We've got you addicted to morphine." Mm-hmm. And I knew what it was to move into that addiction. Wow. And then mix it with other, because it relieved pain. I didn't mm-hmm. think I had a, it's a prescription. The enemy will do anything to be able to rob a crown. Mm-hmm. And you know, there are trials that come into our life. Ben, if you'd put up Romans chapter 5, and we're going to look at five verses, the first five verses. That's a lot to have to put on the screen. But those of us who've been saved, that means we're justified by our faith, and we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the first thing the enemy wants to do. Mm-hmm. When we've got a trial in our life as a Christian,
yeah,
is there's something wrong in our life, and the God's done, he's mad at us, or
right.
Where is God when this mm-hmm. is going on, okay? But we have peace with God,
yes.
Okay? That's not the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's go on a little further, and it says that we exalt, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Well, we haven't got time to flip over to it right now, but Colossians 1:27 tells us what that hope of the glory of God is. Do you have any clue, Honey Tree, what that might be? What is the hope of the glory?
Christ in us.
That's exactly right. Christ in us. That's the hope of glory.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's where it starts. I want Christ to be formed in me.
Yeah.
Okay? Well, now, look what the very next verse says. Back in Romans chapter 5 and verse 3, we don't just rejoice in that, not only this, but we also rejoice, that looks like a contradiction,
yeah,
in our tribulations.
Mm-hmm.
rejoice in our tribulations? I don't know, Honey Tree, if you'll remember this at all, but shortly after my accident, I don't know if you had been in one of your conferences with this man or what it was, but years ago, you gave me a book by a man named Tim Hansen.
Tim Hansen. Oh, yes. I do remember seeing him in a conference, and he was somebody that dealt with a lot of pain.
Yeah, he had a horrible fall, mm-hmm. apparently. He was a mountain climber or something.
Yes.
And he wrote a book called You Gotta Keep Dancing.
Mm-hmm.
And you gave me a copy of that book.
Wow, praise the Lord.
And I treasured that book because there was a quote in it that our friend Abel Robles, a pastor in Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. He had it made for me as a plaque. And I kept it till I met a little boy who lost his legs in a car accident, and I gave the plaque to him. And the plaque said this, "Pain is inevitable. Misery is optional."
Mm-hmm.
That
sounds like something Tim Hansen would have said. He was a good communicator. He was funny, and but it was like that sort of elevator speech that he.
Well, that was a
boiled things down
that,
well.
I want you to know that quote during a lot of dark trials.
Say that again.
Pain is inevitable.
Yeah.
Misery is optional.
Mm.
You know, all I have to do is bring up my aching back. And I'm going to meet a whole bunch of people. Well, I'll tell you,
yes.
Pain's inevitable. Misery is optional. Mm-hmm. There are trials that come. But we can rejoice as believers who have peace with God, because now we're on our way to a crown of life that we can receive.
Yes.
Knowing that tribulations, now while we're here, look what it does. It produces in us perseverance.
Mm-hmm.
And that perseverance, says verse 4, it produces in us proven character,
mm-hmm.
and proven character, now it brings about that hope of Christ being formed
Christ
in us.
Praise the Lord.
The hope of glory.
Mm-hmm.
So now there's our first one. That's why it says, look over in James chapter 1 and verse 12, it talks about that very same, it was... James chapter 1, verse 12, blessed is the man who perseveres. Remember, we saw that over in Romans, persevering under trial, for once he's been approved, he'll receive the crown of glory, which the Lord promised to those.
The crown of life?
A crown of life, thank you. Which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Thank you, Honey Tree. So there's our first one. You know, Jesus, who's our example, look what it says about him in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 8. When we're going through a trial, isn't it great to know we've got not only Jesus sitting on the throne, but he's at the right hand of God, making intercession for us as our high priest. And he's touched by the feelings of our weaknesses. Because look, although he was a son, the Son of God, he learned obedience. Jesus learned obedience.
That is amazing.
By the things which he suffered. Wow. No wonder we crown him as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, because he didn't have to.
Right.
But he did that to be our example, that he could say, I know what it is to go through a trial. Okay. Now, here's our second one. It's found over in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 25 and 26. And this is called, now, the incorruptible crown. Everyone who competes in games, you know, we're not going to have the Olympics. Going to miss out on that. Mm-hmm. And there's the example Paul's using, those Olympic games that were going on there. And he says, they exercise self-control in all things, and they do it to receive a perishable wreath. But we, an imperishable. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim, and I box in such a way as not beating the air. But look at the very next verse. Verse 27 goes on to say, but I discipline my body and I bring make it a slave, so that after I preach to others, I myself will not be disqualified. Mm-hmm. Now here comes our an incorruptible crown, an imperishable crown, that now we get. You know, a lot of trials, they come into our life. If we went back to James again, we won't do it right now, but there again, it talks about our attitude. Mm-hmm. And in James, when he talks about that crown of life that we talked about, he said, count it all joy, my brethren, when you go into these various trials. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not excited about a trial to come, but those we really don't have any control over. They are there. We only have control over what our response is going to be to those. But now an incorruptible crown, we have absolute choice.
Okay.
Because these are disciplines in our life. We talked about the author you introduced me to, Tim Hansen. Have you ever heard of M. Scott Peck?
Yes. I don't think I've read anything, though.
Okay. Well, he's got several books. He's passed away now, but he left behind some great, great books. And my very, very favorite, I try to read it every year. It's called The Road Less Traveled. And I love the way The Road Less Traveled begins. The opening statement in the book says, life is difficult. And then it goes on to say, our problem is we're not willing to accept that. So we try to find
the easy way out.
Yeah, easy way out. But the principle that he brings out is this, and the road less traveled, is that these difficulties, okay, are an opportunity to develop discipline in our life. And when we choose to develop discipline in our life, you know, sometimes there's trials, and all we got to do is just persevere to make it through that. Just hang in there. That's why one of the fruit of this Holy Spirit in Galatians 5 is long suffering and patience. You know? But these disciplines in the Christian life, maybe Ben can go over with us to 2 Peter chapter 1 I'm going to come back to Peck in just a minute if I could. But I want to look at the scripture first. 2 Peter 1, verse 5. It says, now for this very reason. Well, we haven't got time, but if we were to go back, the reason that Peter is saying now, for this reason that I just explained, he said in there that we have magnificent promises from God.
Yes.
And we are partakers of a divine nature, okay? Now, that divine nature, we've been given promises that if we will discipline ourselves, we can now develop that. And that's where the crown that's incorruptible comes from. And look at what he says. For this very reason, we apply all diligence in your faith. That's how we got saved. Now we're to supply moral excellence. And then to our moral excellence, we're to discipline ourselves to attain knowledge. And verse 6 says, then we're to keep applying all diligence that knowledge we're now going to add to that self-control. And in our self-control, perseverance. And in our perseverance, godliness. And in our godliness, verse 7 says, now we add to that our brotherly kindness. Brotherly kindness. And in our brotherly kindness, now we add agape love. Okay? There are 8 of those.
Yeah.
8 in the scripture is the number of new beginning. Jesus was resurrected the 8th day. That's a new beginning in our life. And we're new creatures in Christ. And now the Lord says, here's another crown for you. This is an incorruptible crown. If you'll discipline yourselves. We don't like that word.
Yeah. But once you do start developing some discipline, it actually makes life easier.
And that's exactly what M. Scott Peck said. He even goes so far as to say, he sums up in 4 disciplines. And I'm just going to give these to the people, save them reading the book. But they're very, very practical for believers. And M. Scott Peck was a believer, okay? He didn't write it as a Christian book, but he said, here's the first discipline, and that's to delay our gratification. You know, I have a tendency to be an addictive personality, okay? And addictive personalities, we want what we want when we want it. I love my sponsor in the program said to me once, you know what our biggest problem with immediate gratification is? It's not fast enough. If you have 1 hour in life that you can schedule this hour, and it's broken into 2 parts, it's got 10 minutes that's going to be excruciating pain.
Yeah.
Okay. And 50 minutes of pleasure. Which one are you going to take first?
The pain.
See, that's why you're not one of us. Because I want to get my gratification and put that off just as long as I can. Delaying gratification. That's why you're disciplined and can play the guitar. And my ukulele is still sitting over there and I can't play a note. Okay. Here's number 2. And he says, we have to learn to be dedicated to truth. You know, Jesus said, if we know the truth, it'll set us free. And I don't know how we got this started with black lies and white lies. And what do we say about the white lies? They're just
little
white lies. Okay. Dedicated to truth. Number 3 is he said that we need to accept responsibility. Wow.
That's a big one.
You know, in the 12-step program, it says that, first of all, we had to admit that we were powerless. And in that step, we haven't got time to go through these all tonight, but in there it says that we had to admit to ourselves You know, it's one thing to be honest to you, but to be honest with yourself, mm-hmm. boy, that's rigorous yeah. honesty. And it says that not only you're addicted to a substance, but that your life had become unmanageable. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people stick something into that step. They stick a word "and" in there. Admitted that I'm powerless over, and my life became unmanageable. And the problem with that is it's saying, well, when you're under the influence, you can't manage your life. But that's not how the step is written. Mm-hmm. The step is written with a dash there. We admitted that we were powerless, dash. Not only that, you know, with or without that, mm-hmm. I can't manage my own yeah. life. That's dedication to truth. Mm-hmm. A little later in the steps, it even goes on to say this. It says that we, you know, confess to God, to ourselves, and another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. Mm-hmm. Wow. Discipline. And he said the last was to stay balanced.
Oh, that's so important.
There, you know, in Proverbs, it's repeated a couple of times. It says pretty harsh words, but it says, a false balance is an abomination to God.
Yes.
Wow. And, you know, how many times don't we get our lives out of balance?
Yeah.
Wow. Well, that's our second crown. Our third crown is found over in 2 Timothy chapter 4, the very last letter that Paul is writing, okay, that we have any record of. Mm. And in that last letter to the young pastor Timothy, he says in 2 Timothy 4 and verse 8, here's a third crown. And the third crown, he said, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all those who have, here it is, this crown comes to those who love his appearing. Okay? I wonder how many people really are
looking forward to Jesus' return.
Yeah. That they really want him to come. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was raised in where you got saved when you were uh-huh. a teenager. So I remember growing up in church, mm-hmm. hearing that the Lord was coming anytime.
Right.
I didn't want him to come till I was 16.
That's because you wanted to drive.
I wanted to drive a car. and then, you know, there are a lot of other things I won't get into now, but yeah. Let's just hold. And I think there are a lot of people. Mm. And, you know, the first is to look for his coming. But it's another thing to long for his coming. Mm-hmm. And then it's a whole other thing to live for his coming.
Yes.
You know, if we... I'm saying this to myself with the we, okay? You can jump in only if you want to. Mm-hmm. But if I could really know what it is, I tease about it sometimes, but I kind of wish I had it back, I think. Because I remember hearing about the coming of the Lord so much. And my mom and dad went away on a missions trip. And they had Paul Craig and me, my brother and me, stay at the Guerin's house. Remember Mom and Dad Guerin?
Oh, yes.
And they had a lot more, as Christians, a lot more liberty mm-hmm. in their life, enviably, uh-huh. okay, than...
Maybe a little bit of balance?
They had a lot of balance. And I grew up thinking that movies, if you went to a movie...
You weren't going to be ready when the Lord came.
Now, if the Lord came. If the Lord come back and find you in a movie theater... Mm-hmm. You know, whoa. Uh-huh. And I probably have told you this story a dozen yeah. times. But,
well, not a dozen.
Well, I remember they took us to Old Yeller. Uh-huh. And I think I probably would have maybe gone ahead and peeked and watched it. But there was a family in the church called the Muellers. And this was down at the Embassy Theater, down to the old days when the theaters were downtown. Uh-huh. And we were all standing in line to be able to get into the Embassy Theater outside to get in. And I looked in the line, and there was Georgia Mueller and her daughter Janine waiting to go into the movie theater. And instead of going, well, they're going in, I went, oh, my, they saw me.
Okay.
And so I had to be spiritual. And I watched the whole movie. I was in the whole movie, but I never saw one thing. I was grown up before I ever saw Old Yeller, the movie. But, you know, I know we should stay balanced, and I want to. I think you could probably end up going to heaven from a movie theater in the rapture. But, boy, I would sure like to know what it is to say, Lord, I'd like to have a little bit of that back, that I'm living my life in light of the coming of the Lord.
Yes.
That I'm longing for the coming of the Lord. That I love the appearing of the Lord.
Yes.
And proof of it is living that way. That's a crown of righteousness.
Wow, that's wonderful. That comes.
Then there's one.
You know, your mother used to say this. She would say, she was comforting me when little JR went to heaven, my son that died when he was 2 hours old. And she said, you know, heaven is sweeter because you have a little boy there. And where your treasure is, there will your heart be. Wow. Of course, now I have my husband there, your mother, your dad.
Your mother.
My mother and
your
dad.
Your father.
So many. And, you know, I think maybe I'm loving the coming of the Lord more these days because of that reunion. Not only with him, but with so many.
Oh, my. And, you know, Honey Tree, years ago at Taylor University down at Upland, it's the first time that I ever had this experience growing up. I went to a basketball camp. Didn't do a thing for me. But I was there for 11 days. And it's the first time, as an elementary boy, an elementary school boy, that I'd been away from home.
Mm.
And I experienced homesickness.
Sure.
But now, 70 years old, I've never been there.
Mm-hmm.
It seems strange to say you're homesick for some place that you've never been.
Right.
But I do find myself feeling that way.
I think about it a lot more these days.
Well, that's why we all the more reason to love his appearing, because that's how our guarantee is going to be to get there. And if we live that way, there'll be a crown waiting for us. And then there's another one, and we're going to have to pick up here next week. I wish we could have gotten all five done, but I don't want to just skip through these last two. And I think this next one coming up is going to be of particular interest to you.
Okay.
Have I got your curiosity?
Yeah.
Up? Well, you got to come back next week.
Okay.
To find out what that fourth crown is going to be. All right. Sure. And we'll look at these last two in the scripture, and then we'll hopefully get even more excited about being able to be gathered around that throne. And there we're going to be able to sing, Thou Art Worthy. But you know what? There's another song that I'd like to kind of close out with.
Sure.
And
try not to start it in E flat.
Probably what I'll let you do is find it, and then I jump in with you.
Sure.
Because there's one that goes right along with this. And you know, we didn't mention this, but there's someone rather conspicuous by his absence. And that's my son Andrew, Pastor Andrew. And he's given his voice, but he's not here. Ben and he recorded before we got started because they've had a death in their family.
Mm-hmm.
His wife's brother went to be with the Lord. And what a privilege Andrew had to pray with Sean there on his deathbed.
Wow.
And accept Jesus as his personal Savior.
That's great.
And I'm sharing that because perhaps there's some that tuned in that they've never known what it is to ask Jesus into their heart. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't, you can do that right now wherever you are, whatever's going on in your life. You can know this excitement that Honey Tree and I are talking about, and Honey Tree writes songs about, and we love sharing. We want to do all that we can to invite you to go to heaven with us. And the way that you can have access there, think of it. You don't have to do any works to get there. You do works because you're on your way there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a gift that the Lord gives to you if you'll simply accept it. It's the gift of salvation that you receive by faith, believing that you're a sinner and confessing that you're a sinner and you need a Savior, and Jesus came to do that, and you simply say, Jesus, come into my heart and I accept you as my personal Savior right now. If you'll pray that prayer wherever you are, I promise you, He'll answer it and become your personal Savior. And you can be on your way to heaven just like us. And when we arrive there, we're going to sing, Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord. The elders, the 24 elders, and angels bow. And while we're here, the redeemed, we worship you now. Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord.
Let's see, is that too high?
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. The elders and angels bow. The redeemed, we worship you now. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord.
It should be up a little higher, though, shouldn't it?
Well, if you get me started, I'll join you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The elders and angels bow. The redeemed, we worship you now. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The elders and angels bow. The redeemed worship you now. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. The elders and angels bow. The redeemed, we worship you now. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord.
Thank you for joining us tonight for Calvary Christian Fellowship's Bible study on Revelation. We do hope that you'll be back with us next Wednesday as we continue this study. We'll be airing that at 6:30 p.m. on our Facebook and our YouTube page. And if you do have any questions about tonight's study or perhaps anything about Revelation or biblical prophecy, reach out to us and let us know. We'll be sure to answer your questions in one of our upcoming studies. We also do want to hope and encourage you to, as we invite you to come and worship with us this and every Sunday at 233 West Main Street, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46802. Again, this is the Community Center in downtown Fort Wayne, and we would love to see you. So come and worship our great God with us this and every Sunday, 10 a.m. at 233 West Main Street, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46802. And if you have been blessed by this service, and you want to be a blessing to Calvary Christian Fellowship with your tithes or your offerings of support, you may mail them to Calvary Christian Fellowship, P.O. Box 25544, Fort Wayne, Indiana, 46825. We do thank you for your support and prayers, and until Sunday, may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you as he lifts up his countenance upon you and gives you peace. See you Sunday.